time in front of the Blessed Sacrament, like, just fed the idea that I had maybe a call, you know. That and a lot of other, those interesting little circumstances, the ways that God kind of puts people and things in your way, it kind of, and keeps, like, nudging you. It's like, okay, yeah, that was, all right, I'll look into that, Lord, you know, and it kind of moved from there.
Welcome to the I Am Here podcast, a space to be inspired by stories of men and women who have found in the Eucharist the strength and purpose for their lives. I'm your co-host, Leo Butalid, and I've been gathering stories for IamHere.org.
And I'm Father Mario Amore, a priest of the Archdiocese of Detroit, and today we welcome our guest, Deacon Bob Calleja, to share his story. Welcome, Deacon.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, thanks for joining us. We are so grateful to dive into your story, but first let's get to know you a little bit. Tell us a little bit about where you're from, what do you do?
So grew up in Redford, have two brothers, you know, blue collar sort of family life, you know, really close though. Grew up playing sports and do all the usual things. My dad's Catholic, mom's Lutheran. They had a great devotional life, but not, didn't quite maybe know how to evangelize us as children in certain ways. So we didn't have a real proper formation. So went through my 20s as a young man searching, until I finally found in my heart a call from God up north in the woods, actually. It's kind of an interesting story. Just felt called to pull my shoelace out, tie two sticks together, stick them in the ground on a hill up there by myself and say, Lord, I don't know what you want from me, but here I am.
Wow.
And the next year, up there with some friends, my wife came up with another friend. Well, she wasn't my wife then.
Okay.
And so we met, and we started dating and started going to church together because she was Catholic. And when I knew I wanted to propose to her, we wanted to be married in the church, and I had to go through RCIA.
Got it.
Which was, like, awe-inspiring for me. It woke me up. I remember coming out of the first session, just shaking until I said, my whole life, I've been waiting to hear this message, and I didn't know what I didn't know, you know?
Wow. So you said your father was Catholic and your mom was Lutheran.
Mm-hmm.
So were you baptized Catholic?
Yes.
Okay. But not really practicing as...
My mom had a great love for Jesus. My grandmother, I always say she was the first saint I ever met. You know, really complicated, you know, bone cancer, great pain. As a kid, you never knew it. She had such joy, just love for the Lord and such joy in her life. And it wasn't too much later you realize, wow, she somehow put on that just love and radiance of Christ in the middle of, you know, just for us as her grandkids and that sort of thing. So that radiated through my mom's life. My dad had his own private devotional life. You know, he went to Catholic school all the way through in Detroit. They didn't have an intellectual faith. Mm-hmm. It was just a devotional faith, and they didn't really quite know how to bridge some of the differences. Although there wasn't that much different, because my mom goes to church. As kids, sometimes we go to either one, and as a little kid, you didn't feel much difference, because it was very liturgical in the way that they practiced and that sort of thing. So, I guess when it came time for catechism and all that, life being busy in the early 80s and stuff like that, it just kind of slipped by.
So you are, jump ahead first and then we'll go back.
Yeah.
So today you are a husband and you're a deacon in the Catholic Church. So the Lord has worked pretty amazingly in your life to bring you to the clerical state and to be just this great witness to the church and to your family. So if we go back to life as a kid, so you mentioned, you know, your parents were more devotional. And so can you talk about specifically like what kind of witness in terms of devotion, did you see your dad, you know, praying, and how did that affect you?
Yeah, so didn't see him praying that often, like where he would be, he'd kind of go in his room and close the door kind of thing, you know, but there'd be a rosary laying around his bed, you know, And, you know, as a kid, like, oh, this is kind of a neat necklacey thing. You know, I didn't know how to ask what it was exactly. But eventually he kind of showed me what it was. Mm-hmm. And Mom, you know, she taught us to pray. You know, she taught us the Lord's Prayer. And she, you know, I know just in her own heart, you know, she had always, she'd speak of, you know, Jesus in different ways throughout, you know, life. And when you're, you know, she's teaching us to make moral choices and try to make good choices in life and that sort of thing. So just that kind of really sort of pure love that she had for him that stuck with me, and it just kind of stayed in there. So even in my sort of years of wandering in my 20s, even if I was maybe not doing the best things, somehow this is where I think the Lord had his just hand on my shoulder, because even after those end of those nights, you know, it could be 3 a.m. or whatever, I'd lay in the bed, I would still say the Our Father. Even if I felt like unworthy to say it, mm-hmm. it was still there, you know, mm-hmm. and so it was like there was always a primer for, mm-hmm. for my faith to come alive when it did big time.
Mm-hmm. It sounds like it. So, what kind of led you to that moment where it did come to life in a big way, where you turned to the Lord and, you know, just sought Him for the first time?
Yeah. So, like, I guess, you know, probably in my mid-20s, I kind of started to wanna. I was interested in wisdom, like how do we understand like our place in life, and mm-hmm. so I went to the library. I take like Aristotle, Metaphysics out of the library. I didn't know how to read it. I was just thumbing through it, but I'd find little things like the, you know, first cause argument for God. And I'm like, yeah, that makes, you know, that's beautiful. That really, you know, makes it kind of like solid in that way, or mm-hmm. just things like that. And so I'd find those kind of things. And then, you know, after living through a lot of, you know, my 20s, just having a good time with my friends, it started to ring hollow. Mm. You know, it wasn't enough. It was fun. I had a great time. I have great friends. But it was like there was something missing, you know? And it was just like, it was kind of an end of a long holiday weekend up there, just having a good time. And I just felt like taking a walk. And then I kind of went up on this hill that was on the property. It was kind of like a really beautiful vantage point, you know, up in West Branch area. And just the wind, it was like the Holy Spirit was in the breeze, because wow. it just hit me. Like, and all of a sudden I just felt convicted, and that's when I did that thing with my shoelace, and, you know, I can't explain it more than that, other than it was like God said, okay, now, I'm calling you now.
And how old were you at that time?
26. Okay. Yeah.
Wow.
So.
Okay, and then it was the following year you met your wife, mm-hmm. and then she was a big catalyst into, you know, entering the church, right?
Yeah, for sure. You know, she had kind of had a little bit of a similar journey, although, you know, she had gone through made all the sacraments, but, you know, she had been, you know, living out of state, came back, mm-hmm. and she was kind of finding her way back mm-hmm. into faith, you know, so kind of when we came together and we decided we were dating, we should go to church, you know, mm-hmm. with her family or my dad or something, and or just by ourselves. And it kind of we kind of pushed each other that way, and because it felt natural. It wasn't like, hey, let's go to church, I'm tired, you know. No, it was like, let's go, you know, okay, let's do it, you know. And it felt like again, God was kind of moving us both back to Him. Wow. You know,
that's beautiful. And tell us about, you mentioned briefly, you know, your first meeting at RCIA, feeling really convicted there.
Yeah.
What was it that was so thrilling to you, I guess, to hear this for the first time in a big way?
So I was out, we were dating, we were going to Shrine, it's a little flower, we okay. both had moved out into the Ferndale area, we were going to Shrine Little Flower, so that's where I went to, and that's where we were going to get married, so mm-hmm. I went to RCIA there, and the guy that was there, his name was John LaCroix, I think. He was an old professor kind of guy, and he just started right off the bat with, like, here's how we can understand God exists. You know, he entered right into those philosophical places that I had found a little bit on my own, and then he brought in, you know, some of the ideas of the church, some of the, you know, a little bit of Aquinas and a little bit of, and just that just piqued my interest, like these thinkers, these great thinkers mm-hmm. who had, you know, great devotion to the Lord. And it kind of swirled around in my mind right there, and I was like, you know, all these questions that I just kind of like been floating around were making sense, or had a source, mm-hmm. and they were coming, I was finding it in a sense, you know.
Mm-hmm. And in the beginning when I was speaking about kind of your life now, I failed to mention that you're also a father.
Yes.
And this was during this time of adoration, you know, this was something that was on you and your hearts, your wife's hearts. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about just the prayer of your heart and then how the Lord answered that?
Yeah, sure. So, you know, we'd been married, our daughter was born in 2007, we were married in 2001. So, you know, we got about 6 years in there, and we had hoped to have a family. My wife had kind of a, when she turned 30, it was kind of a late onset type 1 diabetes that came on. Her dad had a similar experience, and so we were dealing with that, and it seemed like, you know, for that reason and other reasons, we just weren't able to have a child, you know. But we were prayerful, and our prayer life was really strong, and we were doing a holy hour, like every Monday morning, you know, 6 a.m. kind of thing. And you know, that was right around 2007, when a lot of my friends they were all married now, and they were starting to have kids, and you know, kind of like it was bittersweet. Like, yes, I'm so excited for them, but, you know, yeah. why can't we have a child too, you know? And it came down to like kind of one of those things. I always say it's like that idea, if you want to make God laugh, tell him your plans. Because we had gone on vacation beginning of February 2007 down in Arizona, and we're like, you know what, if we can't have kids, let's just live a life, you know, together, a devotional life, when we'll travel, do all those things, you know. And I think right there God was kind of snickering. So we got back, went back to our Monday holy hour, and as we left, Christine said to me, did you smell that in there? She said it was so beautiful. It was like the most beautiful like rose scent I've ever smelled in my life. I was like, no, I didn't smell anything. But okay, wow, neat, you know?
Yeah.
And going to shrine, I'll say that you hear there's a lot of stories about that chapel, mm-hmm. and people finding roses in the snow and things of that sort, answers to prayers. It's really wild. But it was like, wow, that's really neat. So. Okay, so next week we go back for a holy hour, and about halfway through, I smelled it, and it gave me goosebumps. It was really vibrant and really beautiful, and I'm looking around, like I kind of peek up from my prayer, and this is the middle of February. There's no flowers around. There's nothing around, and I'm like, okay, so just went back and prayed, and we went on our way out. I said, I smelled it today. It was beautiful. And she's like, smelled what? I'm like, there's no way. Because I've been in the trades a long time, painting, you know, ceiling, all that kind of stuff. My sense of smell is not that great. So I was like, there's no way I smelled that you didn't smell it. So it's like, okay, that's weird. 2 weeks in a row like this.
Yeah.
And, well, I what's God have in store? I have no idea what this means, you know. And well, anyway, that day, got a phone call from my sister-in-law, who had befriended a grandmother at a retirement home. She was just visiting, and the granddaughter had gotten pregnant, and you know, she had met her a few months ago before that, and well, she wasn't sure what she was going to do, and my sister-in-law just kind of encouraged her, if you ever want to think about an option, my brother and sister-in-law would love to have a family. Mm. Just put it in a little seed, you know. Well, that day, that morning, out of the blue, she called my sister-in-law and said, if they're really serious about that, I'd like to maybe meet them. You know, in the meantime, Christy and I were like looking at adoption agencies and all that sort of thing. It's very expensive. Mm-hmm. You know, we're like, yeah, we'd love to, but I don't know, you know, how we're going to do that. But it's just like put it in God's hands, you know. So then we met this young lady, hit it off really well, and the plan was drawn up, like we're going to do this. And her grandmother was a good Christian woman. She was really, you know, on board with, you know, wanting to see this through. And so, long story, since it was like what's called a direct placement adoption, we didn't have to go through the agencies. It was like a fraction of the expense. You know, it was exactly how much we had saved up in our savings. Wow. Like for the first time in our married life, we had exactly that amount of money saved. Like, okay, you know, and everything like sort of lined up. And then 3 months later to the day, you know, she was born. I mean, we were in the delivery room. Like I wasn't expecting her to have the baby that day, but she goes into labor. I'm kind of up by her head, you know, just to give her privacy. And I think I probably said about 1,000 Hail Marys. That was so intense, you know, and then she was born. So, so I always, you know, tell her you were my daughter since the day you were born, you know, yeah. I get to, and everything just, it went, you know, as sort of God had planned, I think, in this instance. Wow. And 16 years later, you know, she's an amazing lady.
That's incredible. Wow. I'm so inspired that you and your wife turned to the Lord in this time, particularly in the Eucharist. And I imagine that you did that, you know, on weeks where you didn't receive that kind of consolation or that sign of the scent of roses. How did the Lord in the Eucharist bring you comfort and peace as you were dealing with something really, really challenging?
Yeah, so I've always had a sense when I'm there before Jesus in the Eucharist. I always like that line in St. Paul says, like, in him we live, move, and have our very being, right? Mm-hmm. And I just feel like when I'm there, that, like, right there, I'm being, like, seen and created by him in that moment in a special way, because he's there. He's literally, like, right there in front of me, you know? And so somehow it's like anything that I would take there in my heart, in my prayer, and or with my wife and I together, it just, like, it was, I just had this, like, knowing that, it, like, he's there with me in this moment, in this struggle or this joy, that in that moment of my creation that's taking place presently there, mm-hmm. like, he's fully invested in there, you know? And it just, I don't know, it's just, like, it kind of just resonates with me whenever I'm there before him in the tabernacle or mm-hmm. an exposition. It's just a strong sense of knowing that his will is for me to be at this moment right now, you know?
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Deacon, how has your faith or how has the Lord moved you to be a witness of faith, particularly for your daughter? So you mentioned, you know, in your upbringing, your parents, you know, their faith was more devotional. You would see them doing some things, praying or, you know, finding the rosary lying around. What is your approach to sharing faith?
Yeah, so ever since she was, you know, born, she's always been at Mass with us, you know, so that's ingrained in her. That's what we do, at least on Sundays. We've prayed the rosary together at different times, and or just simple prayers. When she was little, you know, it'd be just like the simple, you know, little prayers, just to ask Jesus for guidance for your day, to be safe at night, all those sort of things. And then I think also as she, you know, as she became a young adolescent, and that was kind of when I felt called to enter into the diaconate formation at this point. And so she got to kind of watch us go through the formation process of that. She would come to, like, the ordination masses, you know, and see all this, you know, happening with the or when, like, I would the different stages that you go through, you know, acolyte and then, you know, lector and different that sort of things. That she would be there. She got to meet the bishops, you know. She got to hold Bishop Battersby's crozier in one picture. It's really cool. she was so thrilled by that. Things like that. I don't know. It was like it's always been a part of our, like, daily life, you know. And so, even when I'm not, or my wife, even when we're not, like, speaking about it, it's in our house. There's images of Christ and the, you know, the Sacred Heart, the Immaculate Heart. It's all over our lives. So I think, I guess I would say, just because we live it, we try to live it yeah. authentically, and that's why I think it means it's strong in her too.
Wow. That's awesome. And so speaking of living it, I know that, you know, turning to the Lord in the Eucharist is still part of your life and spending that time silently before him. What is that time like for you? Like, do you have a go-to way to pray when you are in front of the Blessed Sacrament? Do you have a favorite devotional, or do you simply sit there in silence? What is your approach to that time that you have with Jesus?
So, yeah, usually just go there at first, and I'll say just some prayers of gratitude to mm-hmm. start. Thank him for my opportunity to be there. I'm privileged to work for the church, so yeah. that the first thing in the morning on my work day, I can go into the church and just sit there in the silence and the dark, you know, which is wonderful, or, you know, whenever I need to. And so it's just a prayers of gratitude to start, and then, you know, thinking of the things that I would ask, whether it be for my life or the people that I love, or the, you know, the church, the school in general, all the different petitions. And then I just try to have at least 15 minutes of just, okay, Jesus, I'll shut up now. You talk, you know, try to be open and listen and see what comes of that.
How impactful was your time in adoration on recognizing your call to serve as a deacon?
Very impactful. In fact, so I was with my brothers. We were all contractors for many years together. And then for different circumstances, I decided that I needed to go work, and I needed health insurance, particularly for my wife. And so I said, well, where would I want to work? You know, I've been used to working with myself, you know. Mm-hmm. I thought of, you know, the church. That's where I'd want to be. And so I started working at Old St. Patrick's out in Ann Arbor. Small little chapel church, you know, really strong devotional place. And just, it was like that, I always say, like that place there, because that was the first place where I was like around Jesus like every day. You know, I'd be in the church.
Wow.
And I could just, you know, sit or kneel, or just even while I'm, you know, cleaning up or doing work, just pray. And so time in front of the Blessed Sacrament, like, just fed the idea that I had maybe a call, you know. That and a lot of other, those interesting little circumstances, the ways that God kind of puts people and things in your way, it kind of, yeah, and keeps like nudging you.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, okay, yeah, that was, all right, I'll look into that, Lord, you know, and it kind of moved from there.
Wow. What was it like preparing for just becoming a deacon, serving as a deacon?
It was, you know what, it was a really, really good time of just openness. So the way I approached it was, I'm, you know, like going in, I kind of commit myself, like, I'm just going to be myself, like fully authentically myself, because if God wants me, then that's going to work. Because, you know, I mean, like sometimes you feel like when you go into a situation, like maybe it seems a little more formal, then you have to kind of like live up to that, or act a little, you know, differently in certain ways, like, you know, a little more, maybe the way you're expected to, quote unquote, you know. Like for me, it was like, nah, you know, I just got to be myself, because if God's calling me, I want that. Like if I say something that's a little too, you know, I don't know, whatever, I want them to say that. I want, because they're like the people in formation, the deacons who are leading me, they're appointed to help discern with you the call that you may have. Mm-hmm. So, like, I wanted to hear from them. If like, eh, Bob, you know, maybe you want to tone this down here, or maybe you're on the right path here, but, you know, I wanted that, because it was like, that's what, like, that's how I felt like I would hear Jesus through them and in my own heart, if I just lay it out there and just be myself. So that's how I kind of approached it, you know, and it kind of, I don't know, somehow I guess he still wanted me after all that.
Yeah. Oh, that's awesome.
Deacon, what's your advice to other men who might be struggling in their faith, or other men who might be at that point of, you know, being where you were with the shoelaces and, yeah, you know, kind of putting the stick in the ground there?
Yeah, so I would just say, we have to, like, listen to the voice inside our heart, because that's where God's going to first try to speak to us, especially when we're kind of away from him, in those nudgings and things of that sort. So you have to have like an inner life. You know, the world today tries to, I think, keep us away from listening to the inner life. It's just distraction all over the place. So you have to like cut some of that out and try to listen inside there. And if you do, God will speak to you there, and he'll call you to different things. And if you, I always, you know, he opens a door and you walk through it, and then you keep walking. And if the next door opens, then you walk through that, and you kind of find your way that way. So just, you know, pray, and just have that, seek that inner life, and seek that place where God is creating you in your life.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do that, then he'll lead you where he intends you to go.
Mm-hmm. You know? But I think it's really cool. for the listeners, I know Deacon's brother as well, probably, well, better than you.
Yeah, sure.
Better than I know you, not better than you know your brother.
Yeah.
And Deacon's mom is also our housekeeper at our rectory. And what I really admire about your brother and you as well, and I know your other brother too, is the fact that you're all using your gifts at the service of the church. And their gifts of like woodworking and like maintenance, you know, and so like you've lost none of that, those gifts that God has given to you, and you use that for just for service in the church and just what God has given to you as men to be His witnesses. And I'm sure it's the case for you, I know it's the case for your brother as well, that you're always looking for the opportunity in those not really churchy things, you know, like, mm-hmm. yeah, you're in the church, but you're fixing a pipe or something like mm-hmm. that, to be that witness and to share the gospel. And I think that's where like real evangelization happens. And so I think it's really just edifying and truly a witness, the witness that we need.
Thank you. Right. This is what God kind of made us to be. My brothers and I are all kind of very similar in that way, and we feel His call to live this life. I always say, like, you know, I feel like Jesus can relate to guys like us. You know, he was a tradesman too. Yeah. You know, yeah. And Saint Joseph and these guys, they were out there working alongside mm-hmm. other guys with bloody hands and bloody knuckles and, you know, sore backs and all that sort of thing, doing those kind of things. And so when I feel like all of us, especially when we get to do things like woodwork, there's a prayerful aspect to it. There's a way in which we kind of, like, I know from talking to Keith and Todd both, that you kind of, it makes it a prayer. You're uniting, you know, your talent with what the Lord was able to do in His life, in His earthly life, and that sort of thing. And there's something, I don't know, special and prayerful about doing that, you know. And a lot of guys out there that work and live in the trades, unfortunately, it's not the holiest place out there in the world. Maybe, like, but part of what I feel called to, I'll say this real quick, is trying to reach out to the guys that I know, the guys who tend to, you know, be a little rougher around the edges and that sort of thing. But because God's calling them, and God wants them, and wants them to find Him in their lives and in that just gritty world of work, you know. So hopefully that'll play out.
Yeah.
That's what I feel is in my heart right now, anyway.
That's wonderful. Well, thank you so much, Deacon Bob, for joining us today and for just sharing your heart, what the Lord has done in your life, and for continuing to be a witness everywhere that you go to His goodness. We're very grateful that you would do that.
It's my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for listening to the I Am Here podcast. You can read and listen to more stories of people encountering Jesus in the Eucharist at iamhere.org. And we also invite you to share your story with us. I Am Here is a campaign by the Archdiocese of Detroit and Hallow App in support of the National Eucharistic Revival.